Hello everybody and welcome to Paul Ricard for the fifth race of the 2016 SEAT Leon Eurocup Championship. It's Ben Evans here in the commentary box on a beautiful day in the south of France, and we are just about ready for 11 laps of action from the ultra-competitive SEAT Leon Eurocup. The sun has been beating down throughout the course of the morning, and as we head into the afternoon of racing, this really is perfect weather to enjoy some motorsport. Cars lining up on the grid ahead of the race, the heat haze shimmering off, and lining up in pole position is Niels Langeveld, Dutchman, currently third in the championship standings, but has been very impressive throughout the course of the season. He's only really down third in the standings because he didn't finish last time out in Silverstone. Mikael de Schoone, who lines up second, is indeed second in the championship standings. Schoone, who started the season in Estoril in winning ways, he will be looking to get back onto the top step of the rostrum once more today. Lining up in third on the grid, it is Alex Morgan, and Morgan currently fifth in the championship, returning for his second year in the SEAT Leon Eurocup, albeit with a different team for 2016, the Wolf Power Racing squad. And then in fourth, it is the championship leader, Stian Paulsen, who's already had two victories this season, hasn't yet finished off the podium. And Paulsen, who came so close to the title back in 2014, was competitive. If unlucky, 2015 will 2016 be his year. Fifth on the grid, it's the Argentinian Facundo de la Mota, who's moved over from the TC 2000 Championship, running with the Vapporo Motorsport squad, who took pole Roselle to the last two SEAT Leon Eurocup titles. Grid just beginning to be cleared as we glimpse into the cockpit of the sixth place car on the grid. That's the Portuguese driver, the raincoat bear out, De Viega. And De Viega finishing second in the reverse grid race at Silverstone. Lining up in seventh place, Julien Brichet in the JSB competition car. And Brichet, who finished fourth in last year's championship, third the year before, but not yet featuring really in this year's championship running. Here's how they line up in full then. Niels Langeveld and Mikael de Schoone on the front row. Then it is Alex Morgan and Stian Paulsen, row two. Facundo de la Mota and Lorenzo Bairau de Viega on row three. Then Julien Brichet and Nelson Lukes, clear of Lucile Cypriano and Mary Bauskapens. Then Lucas Oric and Moritz Sandberg completing the field. And arguably a talking point from qualifying is Lucile Cypriano, fourth in the championship standings, to be so far down the grid. But of course, today's race, the grid is set by the order in which they qualify. Tomorrow's race, the top cars from qualifying are reversed, and so that's going to give some of those a little bit further down the pack the chance to improve. Because one of the challenges here at Paul Ricard is it's such a technical circuit and with such expansive runoff as well, that if you haven't done much testing or practice here, it's actually quite a tricky circuit to find your reference points and to really nail a good lap. So the race will be over 11 laps. If we do see the intervention of a safety car, then it could potentially revert to time, which is a 40-minute time limit on the race. As the last couple of mechanics are wave clear of the grid, the cars starting to fire up. And then we will be off on the sighting lap of the Paul Ricard circuit. One of the longer layouts in the season, this high-tech test track. As you'll see, the circuit has always been at the cutting edge of technology. When it was built in the early 1970s, it was, for that era, absolutely state-of-the-art, with a reasonably significant runoff area and also a clearly designated pit lane. And then, having hosted the French Grand Prix through until 1990, alternating some years with Dijon-Prenois, then the track slipped away from certainly four-wheeled prominence, but then has had significant amounts of investment. And now, as a high-tech test circuit, is used by teams throughout the world of motorsport as really the perfect testing venue. It also produces some great racing as well, and that's what we're looking forward to over the course of the next 40 minutes or so. The field off onto their green flag formation lap. You can see how the track's already rubbering in. Just got a glimpse there of the blue asphalt, which is studded with a little bit of tungsten, because the runoff areas here being so extensive, the tarmac runoff, in order to penalise the drivers for making mistakes, has got two different types of higher grip asphalt laid down. So the blue stripes is high grip asphalt, which slows the car down, costs the drivers time, whereas the red stripes that you can see there, well, that is much more abrasive asphalt that will more likely than not flat spot the tyre, if not cause a puncture. And so whilst obviously it stops the cars ending up in the barrier and picking up damage, it's also abrasive enough that the driver do get punished if they make a mistake that sees them get off onto that part of the circuit. So Lucas Oryk's team just waiting in the pit lane for the cars to come back from the formation lap as they run down the legendary Mistral straight. This is really probably the archetypal shot of Paul Ricard, the heat haze shimmering off the cars in the early June sunshine. And then they're just arriving into the chicane, which comes midway down the Mistral straight, and they come out of the chicane, which turns 89, on towards the Corbe du Cygne. It's one of the highest speed corners here, Paul Ricard. Well, they then head into the more technical final third lap. What that means, of course, is that this is actually a really quite tricky circuit to get the car set up correctly for, because on one hand, you want to be running with a reasonably low level of downforce, so that the car is slippery through the air all the way along the Mistral straight, and also the lengthy front straight. But then the technical section towards the end of the lap, you still need enough grip to be able to really hit the apex. Something that's going to be absolutely key today as well is how the teams have set up the Yokohama tyre that they all run on, because it's a circuit where you can run through your tyres quite quickly. A lot of long radius corners coupled with a reasonably high track temperature means that we've seen some of the other races already today that tyre wear has started to become an issue, with drivers starting to suffer from pretty acute understeer as the race unfolded. So all the drivers in the race equipped with the SEAT Leon Eurocup racer, powered by a four-cylinder turbo engine. It produces some 330 brake horsepower, and then they've got the benefit of the six-speed gearbox. It's a very affordable way of going racing at an international level in a touring car, but also a very high-performing car as well, which the drivers find thoroughly enjoyable. There is Lucile Cypriano. Be fascinated to see how she progresses through the field as the race unfolds. She's been one of the top Lady Driver Trophy runners of 2016 and has featured on the podium as well, of course, including last year, scoring victory in one of the SEAT Leon Eurocup races. So here comes the car of Niels Langeveld, our pole sitter. Langeveld, who won the first race at Silverstone, retired in race two, and it's that inconsistency of that retirement which has unfortunately meant that he's dropped almost 30 points away from Stian Paulsen in the title fight. But this weekend, a good opportunity to fight back. This the third of seven rounds of the SEAT Leon Eurocup season. So the colours to watch for then, the white car with the red and black, that's Niels Langeveld. The predominantly white car with the black bumper is Mikael Ascona. The row behind the car with the fluorescent yellow flashes is Alex Morgan, and the car with black side piping, fluorescent yellow wing mirrors, is Stian Paulsen. Get the green flag away from the marshal at the rear of the field. The fifth round of the SEAT Leon Eurocup about to get underway now, as everybody looks towards the gantry. We wait for the red lights to flash on, which they do now. The revs begin to rise. Who's going to get the jump from the line? And away we go. And Mikael Ascona anticipated that absolutely beautifully and may well get the jump on Niels Langeveld. But Langeveld's just got enough underneath him as he and Ascona go elbow to elbow, make contact, heading towards turn one. Somehow they all keep it pointing in broadly the right direction, or do they? Ascona then kicks it sideways, swinging out of turn two. as running wide is Alex Morgan, and that was maybe a little bit unnecessarily aggressive as Langeveld is the beneficiary. He already starts to build the advantage. Paulsen slips the inside of Morgan. He snatches third just behind Michele Schoner as the field all cleanly through. The opening exchange is out to the furthest extremity of the circuit before they start to swing back, begin the build-up through turns 6 and 7 on to the Mistral straight. So well up is Nelson Lux and Julian Brichet. They've both had a good start for Kundo de la Motta and Lorenzo Beira de Viega. As a result, losing out just a little bit as Ascona tries to get onto terms with Langeveld as they sprint down towards the chicane. Paulsen in third. It's got Morgan snapping at his heels. Then it's Nelson Lux. Julian Brichet next along. Lorenzo Beira de Viega launching to the inside of Facundo de la Motta. And also Lucile Cypriano trying to join in that scrap as well, as Branko Beira de Viega looks to defend. Heading down the Mistral straight, he draws alongside Facundo de la Motta. De la Motta has to slip back into the train. And then Lucile Cypriano also looking to find a way past. Meanwhile, at the front of the field, Langeveld has got Michele Schoner bottled up right behind him. In fact, runs a little bit wide. And this is always really tricky here at Paul Ricard, because the constant changes of direction through the final phase of that means it's quite easy to run alongside your rival and begins up for a move several corners in advance of it actually happening. But Michele Schoner then drops back again from Langeveld. That's good news for Langeveld as Facundo de la Motta runs wide. It opens the door for Lucile Cypriano, the number four car, snatching a break there. That's Lucas Oruc trying to join in as well. And Oruc was competitive in Estoril. So they flash over the line. And the lead for Langeveld, 1.3 seconds over Michele Schoner. But what we have seen time and time again in the SEAT Leon Eurocup is that if you can get dicing with the cars around you, it's going to start to form a train. At the same time, if you can get a little bit of daylight, because these cars are, to all intents and purposes, pretty much identical, barring the odd setup tweak, it can be very hard for your rivals to chase down the gap once it's opened up. Cypriano darts the inside of Facundo de la Motta. De la Motta slots in behind, but is demoted to ninth position as a result. Then we've got Lucas Oruc, Marie Bauskapens part of that scrap as well. Meanwhile, Julian Brichet has found a way past Nelson Lux up into fifth position. He swings out of turn 7. Let's have another look then at the start of the race. And contact between Ascona and Langeveld. Fortunately, they didn't get entangled and spear off into the barrier. But then Ascona, yeah, a little bit of a tap from Alex Morgan as well. There is Morgan in fourth, as again Ascona pushing just a little bit too hard, running wide at the chicane. All of this is helping Niels Langeveld in his bid to break clear at the front of the field. As Langeveld punches the hole in the air down the Mistral straight, Ascona trying to catch up to him. Stian Paulsen, in fact, if anything, a little bit closer to Ascona. Then Morgan in clear air in fourth. Good scrap for fifth between Brichet, Lux, and now Lorenzo Beira de Viega. And it's Beira de Viega, the black and white car at the tail of the train, who's closed down that gap in absolutely no time at all. Well, the incident at the start, our timing screen tells us, is under investigation between Michele Schoner and Niels Langeveld. So we'll update you if any action is taken. They currently hold the first two places in the race. Certainly an argument that neither driver really gained an advantage as a result of that contact. They qualified first and second. They run first and second. And they come through to complete the second lap of the race now. The lead was 1.3 seconds at the end of lap one. It's down to 0.9 seconds at the end of lap two. But Michele Schoner's just been struggling for consistency. You get the feeling that Schoner has got a very, very quick car underneath him. You can just get it hooked up to really pursue and then challenge Langeveld. Third place Stian Paulsen, fourth Alex Morgan. Morgan having his best result of the season last time out at Silverstone, finishing third place in the reverse grid race. The driver finished fifth in the championship last year. And Paul Ricard, the circuit that Michele Schoner likes very much indeed. He dominated the opening round of the 2015 championship, which was held here at Paul Ricard last April. transpired to be his only victory of the season en route to third in the championship. But nonetheless, he's going to try to reel in Langeveld. Meanwhile, Lorenzo Berra de Viega has found a way past Nelson Luke, so Berra de Viega up into sixth position. His next target is Julien Brichet. Seventh place then is now Luke's. Eighth is Lucile Cypriano. Ninth, Facundo de la Motta. Tenth, Lucas Oruc. 11th, Marie Bouws-Coppens. And what about this battle between Nelson Luke's and Lorenzo Berra de Viega? Berra de Viega already easing away from Luke's as Ascona closing up on to the tail of Niels Langeveld once more. And now the reel is running very, very wide. Stian Paulsen, they're going to have to be careful of the track limits here. Indeed, third through to fifth, all had four wheels well over the white lines at the edge of the circuit. And that is the point at which it just starts to get the interest of the race director in terms of obeying track limits, particularly if the drivers start to gain any sort of advantage. But Paulsen doesn't seem to have gained an awful lot, because running wide through the Courbe du Cygne like that, all you really do is drive some extra metres. Even if you're carrying a bit more speed, it all tends to even itself out. Morgan kicks out of the tight right-hander that brings the lap to the to an end, sprints along past the pit complex into the fourth lap of the race, so already approaching one-third race distance. And now we've got a challenge as Facundo de la Motta and Lucile Cypriano, they're busy battling over 8th and 9th position. And it's de la Motta in the multicoloured car in pursuit of the white machine Cypriano. Cypriano also, by dint of having put de la Motta and Lucas Oruc between herself and Marie Bouws-Coppens, is making certain of the Lady Driver Trophy honours. Oruc now swarms on the tail of de la Motta, tries to get the overlap with de la Motta as they get on the brakes. Swinging downhill to turns 5 and 6 now. Again, because these cars are so similar, it's very, very hard for the driver to make the move and fashion the overtaking opportunity. As we get a notification, you just saw on your screen, that the incident involving cars 1 and 10, the two leaders, Langeveld and Ascona, is going to be investigated after the race. So for now, they're both free to race on, as Langeveld just kicks the car a little bit sideways at the chicane. And this suddenly starts to open up the opportunity now for Mikael Ascona. This is the closest that Ascona has been, really, since the first lap of the race. He's already gained 0.2 seconds through the middle sector on this lap, but it's now the final sector lap where it all starts to rely on consistency, rely on how much grip the driver's got underneath them, how much confidence they've got, and also their ability to pick the right racing line on such a wide circuit. And it's here really where Langeveld has got the advantage over Ascona, but the Dutchman just snatches a break. As he came to the top of the hill, we've got some damage there on Stian Paulsen's car. Let's see when they come into view what that is that's flapping off the side of the Norwegian's entry. Looks like it's just the inner wheel arch of the SAT, but shouldn't hurt his progress too much. It will just cause a distraction. The only risk would be if it fully detached itself and went flying into the path of competitors behind. What it does do, though, is, you know, you can see bits of it breaking clear on the straight as Morgan looks to challenge Paulsen on the brakes into turn one. And what it's also now doing is starting to damage the wheel arch, and that will start to hurt Paulsen, because these cars have got such finely balanced aerodynamics that the flapping wheel arch is just going to cost him a vital tenth or two. But as Morgan darts the inside of Paulsen into turn three. Great move from Alex Morgan. He gains third place and elevates himself up ahead of the championship leader, Stian Paulsen. Paulsen looks to try and fight back as the pair of them run nose to tail through turns 5 and 6, and then swing out of turn 7 onto the Mistral straight. And as they battle, of course, lurking with intent in fifth position is Julien Brichet. Well, the wheel arch's bid for freedom seems to have been temporarily laid, and it looks like it's been caught in amongst some of the bodywork. That's going to be causing a fair amount of friction. There it is. It's just hanging on by a thread. It just means that Paulsen's car isn't quite as aerodynamic in a straight line as you would hope. Another look at the move from Alex Morgan. Absolutely beautifully executed. Ducked out, saw the gap to the inside and pounced. And that's the sort of move that you want to see in touring car racing, clean and close. But of course, as they battle, it means they're now 2.5 seconds back from the leaders, because Langeveld and Ascona, despite really running in tandem throughout much of the race, what they haven't done yet is really engage themselves in battle in the way that I'm sure they will between now and the chequered flag. I think it's also partly the knowledge that once you start battling wheel to wheel in these cars, you slow yourselves down really quite quickly, and that would give Morgan the opportunity to close up. So instead, Ascona just shadow boxing with Langeveld at the moment, parrying and prying the Dutchman for weaknesses, but he's not yet been able to find something he's able to exploit. He's still got just over half the race, however, with which to do so, because he crosses the line now to complete that five. Again, just looks to the inside of Langeveld in towards turn one. Nothing doing. 4 seconds. Their advantage over Morgan in third place. In fourth, Stian Paulsen still under pressure from Julien Brichet. In sixth, then it's Lorenzo Berard de Viega. Seventh, Nelson Lukes. Eighth, Lucile Cypriano. Ninth, Facundo de la Motta. Tenth is Lucas Oric. 11th place, Mario Bauskapens. And in 12th place, Maurits Sandberg. So the field's still intact and fortunately without any incidents to speak of. Now it's coming onto the Mistral straight where Ascona just seems to get the legs on Langeveld. He then is able to close up to the Dutch driver running down towards the chicane, but he never can quite get close enough to enjoy the overlap as he flashes his headlights, tries to distract Langeveld. That's going to have absolutely no effect whatsoever as Langeveld just sticks to the racing line. Ascona still not quite close enough to force him to drive defensively. Ascona then looks to ride the chicanes. Langeveld has to block out the Spaniard mid-apex, and that's smart drone from Langeveld. It just forced Ascona to come out of the throttle momentarily. Meanwhile, here's a replay for Facundo de la Motta to the inside of Lucile Cypriano. So that promotes de la Motta to eighth position. Lucas Oric trying to join in as well. So astute defensive drone from Niels Langeveld, but he just slips a little bit sideways, still goes sideways, the car almost drifting through the turn, but it has not cost him any ground, but it shows just how hard he's trying. Also will be heartening for Mikael Ascona. He knows that the pressure that he's been applying is beginning to pay off in terms of just starting to force a little bit of raggedness from Langeveld, just in terms of beginning to force a couple of defensive manoeuvres as well. It's going to be fascinating at the end of this lap in a couple of moments' time to see what impact that's had on the lap times. Last time, they both circulated in the low 2-minute 19-second bracket. My guess is that this time around, as they complete lap six, it's going to have just elevated the pace a little bit. Indeed, it has. They're a whole second of a lap slower. So a 2 minutes 20 a piece as opposed to a 2 minutes 19. Good news for them is that Alex Morgan isn't really appreciably quicker, so he's not particularly catching them now. The warning flag goes out for track limits to Mikael Ascona, so he's going to just have to be mindful of, particularly through the Corb de Seine, obeying the track limits, not picking up a penalty, because that would be a very, very sad way for this battle to be concluded. Third place, Alex Morgan, has no pressure. In fourth now, Julien Brichet, who has picked his way past Stian Paulsen. Paulsen is there in a fairly secure fifth. There's no particular threat from Lorenzo Berard de Viega. So for Paulsen, while it's not the race he would have hoped for, it will be his first race of the season not on the podium, it will nonetheless net him a fairly useful haul of points. As again, Ascona closes up onto Langeveld into the braking zone at the chicane. Again, Langeveld breaks a little bit deeper than he would have liked, and this time he has to punch onto the throttle, and we might well see a bid for the lead here from Mikael Ascona, because he's going to have, I'd suggest, a far better run down towards the Corps de Seine than Niels Langeveld. Indeed he does, and he's absolutely glued underneath his rear spoiler. Now, can they both make it through cleanly and not run wide? And then can Skoda look to challenge to the inside? They both have a clean negotiation in the Corps de Seine. They get on the brakes. Down at the bottom of the hill, turns 11 and 12, swinging round for the sharp punch uphill to the left-hander at turn 13. Both of them just snatch the brakes. Skoda can't do anything about overhauling Langeveld. Super battle this between the two leaders. Really shows the strength of this championship that they're both running so cleanly. Very, very close racing. But it's just then finding that opportunity to pick your way past. And it doesn't happen on the seventh lap of the race for Michele Ascona. And now he'll just be starting to think, as he can see on the gantry, the track limits warning flag for him. Just be starting to think about where can he pull the pin and make the move on Niels Langeveld, because he's rapidly running out of laps. Just four remaining. Morgan in third, again, lapping consistently in the 2 minute 19.8 bracket. Langeveld and Ascona a little bit quicker on that last lap. They ducked into the mid 2 minute 19 seconds. Suggest that Langeveld wasn't having to drive quite as defensively as previously. As into the pit lane comes Lucile Cypriano, and unfortunately that looks like a stop and reverse. Now, what caused that? Well, here's Cypriano running alongside Mary Bowles-Capens. Two JSB competition teammates running in tandem, and Cypriano just slithering out wide. Now, is that a puncture that she's picked up possibly on the, can't quite see from the angle, but the front right-hand side of the car just seemed to be drooping a little bit. Nonetheless, Cypriano into the pit lane. It promotes Mary Bowles-Capens then to the lead of the Lady Driver Trophy race, as Ascona again gets a superb run on Langeveld coming through the chicane. It really is the section of the Michelin straight that run onto it, the chicane, and then into the Corps de Seine, where Ascona is so strong in comparison to Langeveld. Both of them run through Corps de Seine into turns 11 and 12. Ascona just a little bit more tentative than Langeveld, who still is very confident in carrying the speed through, and climbs into the left-hander at 13. And you just wonder whether or not all of this corner speed, late braking from Niels Langeveld, might pay off into the closing stages for Michele Ascona. If Ascona's taken better care of his Yokohama tyres, will he have something left just to push really hard in the last couple of laps? Also in trouble for Kunde de la Motta. Oh, that's a real shame for the Argentinian, as the light goes off on the SEAT and his race is at an end. So is Cipriano's. As the two leaders head into lap nine. Now, what can Ascona do? This has really been the story of the race. He got a better start than Langeveld, but he couldn't find a way past into turn one. He's then spent the rest of the race really bottled up behind Niels Langeveld, looking every which way to try and find a way past. But at no point has Ascona drawn alongside Langeveld. At no point has he really been able to craft a clear-cut overtaking manoeuvre. For Morgan in third place, after making that mid-race pass on Stian Paulsen, it has been fairly steady going. He's been, by and large, quicker than Julien Brichet behind him, and he's managing that gap. It's about 2.1 seconds. So the race leaders run along the Mistral straight once more. Again, flashing his headlights, Michele Ascona showing himself in Langeveld's mirrors. Can he force Langeveld just to miss the apex into the chicane once more? No, that was very nicely done by Langeveld. Ascona, though, still quicker through the chicane. Morgan also hurls the SEAT through, and that's why Julien Brichet trying to close up a little bit, and Brichet had a good first sector of the lap. It's again the Ascona, the camera angle foreshortening somewhat how close he is to the race leader. He's 1.5 car lengths behind as they turn through Corps de Seine. And now Ascona starts to ask the questions in pursuit through turns 11 and 12, trying to force Langeveld offline, trying to force him to miss an apex, do something that's going to cost him a tenth or two. It's really going to open the door for Ascona to challenge, maybe into turn 13. Langeveld aiming for the late apex, whereas Ascona trying to hug the inside line throughout, actually losing a little bit of ground to Langeveld on that occasion. It means that turns 14 and 15 don't yield anything at all for Ascona, and then he swings out of turn 16, still in pursuit of Langeveld, and Langeveld has now got just two laps between himself and the chequered flag, and his second victory of the season. I think also more ominously for his championship rivals, it would be the second time in three events that Langeveld has taken out the Saturday race victory, which is probably the best indication of the driver's true pace and package for the weekend. And that's why the championship point structure also rewards the driver who puts the car on pole position with an additional five championship points. So for Langeveld, that's going to start to claw him back into contention. He's going to be taking best part of 20 points out of Stian Paulsen's championship lead by the time that they get to the chequered flag, with Paulsen en route to fifth place and therefore a haul of some 10 points. Ascona will also be closing the gap down as well to Stian Paulsen. Again, Ascona flashes his headlights. It makes absolutely no impact at all on Langeveld. And what Niels Langeveld has done throughout the entirety of the race is basically just stuck to his racing line. He's made Mikel Ascona do all the hard work, and there's been nothing that Ascona can do about it. Meanwhile, here is Lorenzo Berra de Viega in sixth. Then this fight for seventh. Nelson Lukes, Lucas Oruk, and Marie Bauskapens. And it's Oruk, the red and white car, snapping at the heels of Nelson Lukes, the white and sky blue machine. Silver car, Marie Bauskapens, watching from behind. And Oruk's going to have a good opportunity here, in fact, I think, to challenge Lukes en route to the Corps du Cygne. Also in the mix is Bauskapens. She'll be looking to try and pick her way past if she can. She can't do it as they swing into the right hand. Just a bit of a clout of the curb for Nelson Lukes, but it doesn't unsettle the car unduly. As he moves across for the double apex right-hander, covers the inside line preemptively because he could see that that's where Lucas Oruk was looking to place his car. Snatch the brake as well from Lucas Oruk. Nelson Lukes doing exactly what Niels Langeveld's been doing, which is just sticking to the racing line, letting the cars behind make the effort, making sure that if you just find the quickest way around the circuit, it doesn't have to be spectacular, but it doesn't leave the door open for anybody. As a result, it's very tricky to pick your way past. It's accelerating along the start-finish straight, about to start the final lap of the race. Already the leading group of cars are gone, but nonetheless, the field has been pretty tightly bunched throughout the course of this race. 26 seconds covering the entire field as they're into the last of these 11 laps, some 222 kilometres an hour through the speed trap at the end of the start and finish straight, as here is our race leader Niels Langeveld. And in fact, it's Langeveld who's really been able to pull the pin in the last lap or so to just open up that advantage over Mikel Ascona. There's nothing that Ascona can do, and he certainly isn't going to be close enough to challenge anything into the chicane. All he can really hope for is a mistake from Langeveld as much as anything, but Langeveld, despite Ascona's bobbing and weaving his rearview mirror, gets the car slowed down nicely, hammers both apexes. Again, not quite carrying as much speed as Mikel Ascona, but that's been the story of the entire race. The difference, but the key factor has been that Ascona hasn't been able to translate that into anything like an overtaking opportunity into the Corps du Cygne, or indeed heading down into the double right hand beyond that. And so it's proving to be on this last lap. Langeveld, just as he has done all race, driving very smoothly, not taking any unnecessary chances, just letting the hot car do the hard work. As he glides through turn 13, on towards turn 14. And into turn 15, and the last lap chance from Michele Scona hasn't materialised. Niels Langeveld is just one corner from home, and his second victory of the SEAT Leon Eurocup for 2016. He heads out of the final turn, accelerates along. The chequered flag is about to go out to Niels Langeveld, who takes it now and celebrates victory in Paul Ricard. Second place to Michele Scona, and it's Alex Morgan who completes the podium, with in fourth place Julien Brichet, fifth championship leader Stian Paulsen, Lorenzo Berrao de Viega accelerating along towards the flag. He takes sixth position. And then who has prevailed in that titanic scrap for seventh? We were watching a few moments ago. It is Nelson Lux who takes seventh, Lucas Oruk in eighth, Marie Bauskapens in ninth, and Moritz Sandberg completes the finishers in 10th position. So Niels Langeveld enjoying the victory lap as we take a look at the classification. So Langeveld wins it in the end, 1.9 seconds clear of Michele Scona, despite the fact that the Scona set the fast lap of the race. Alex Morgan completes the podium in third, then in Julien Brichet in fourth from Stian Paulsen, Lorenzo Berrao de Viega, Nelson Lux, Lucas Oruk, Marie Bauskapens and Moritz Sandberg. Unfortunately, Facundo de la Motta and Lucile Cypriano falling by the wayside at about two-thirds race distance. Terms of the championship then, a difficult day for Stian Paulsen means that all closes up very nicely. Michele Scona just a couple of points back, and Niels Langeveld, another good result, could see him catapulted to the top of the standings, with Alex Morgan consolidating fourth position as well. Marshals along the Mistral Strait waving their flags in salute of Niels Langeveld as he heads long towards Parc Fermé. But of course, his weekend's work is only half done here, because they have got the second race of the weekend to look forward to. That is going to be starting, or our coverage of it rather, will be starting at about 25 to 4, so 15:35 Central European time tomorrow for the second race of the weekend for the SEAT Leon Eurocup. And from Paul Ricard, it's then about 6 weeks off before heading to Mugello on the 16th and 17th of July, then on to the Red Bull Ring on 10th and 11th of September, and then the Austro-German doubleheader continues a weekend later at the Nürburgring on the 17th and 18th of September before the season comes to a close at Barcelona on the 5th and 6th of November. So five races into the season, still nine more to go, and a championship battle which is very nicely poised. With a look ahead towards tomorrow, well, Stian Paulsen will be hoping to make the most of the reverse grid race and look to challenge for victory. For Niels Langeveld, Michele Scona, they'll be looking to get as many points out of proceedings as possible. It's also going to be a chance for some of the drivers who showed great race pace today, like Lorenzo Berrao de Viega, like Lucile Cypriano before she was forced into retirement, to potentially look to push on and score victory. For Niels Langeveld, it wasn't quite the perfect day because he didn't set the fastest lap, but nonetheless, he has taken the maximum possible points from a Saturday of the SEAT Leon Eurocup meeting. Pole position converted into a race win, and he led pretty much every single metre of the race as well. Drivers get applauded into the pit lane by the marshal, and then run along towards Parc Fermé before being announced up on to the Paul Ricard podium. That was just a beautifully, beautifully judged performance from Niels Langeveld, and a really good example for anybody watching at home about how to defend a lead without compromising yourself, without driving overly defensively. Langeveld had a Scona filling his mirrors throughout the course of the race. It didn't faze him at any point. He just stuck to doing the job that he needed to do, absorbed all the pressure that Scona could throw at him, and has been richly rewarded with a fine victory. His second of the season, and one that very emphatically makes him a championship contender. There's a door open, out gets a delighted Langeveld. hot work, I'd suggest, at the wheel of the car. The temperature in the car, obviously, considerably warmer than the ambient air temperature, and being a saloon car, there's not really very much air flowing through either. Plus the fact they're all wearing the thick helmets, the multi-layered Nomex race suits. They've been hot work as Lankveld receives congratulations from the SEAT hierarchy.
Yes! Yes!
I think he rather enjoyed that.
Thank you very much.
We will hope to hear from our race winner in a couple of moments' time. So he unhooks himself from the helmet and hands device. Oh, Mikel Scona, very, very aggressive at the start. But thereafter, he just couldn't quite ever get Lankveld to the point where he's really forcing the Dutchman offline or into an uncomfortable position. It was always Lankveld who was controlling the agenda. It was always a Scona who was having to do the hard work. And for Alex Morgan, very solid third position, having been jumped at the start by Stian Paulsen. He was able to repass Paulsen mid-race, build up the buffer over Paulsen and Julien Brichet, and take that solid third. Well, Mikel Scona pushed as hard as he possibly could, but it didn't quite work out. Niels Lankveld, superb performance for his second victory of the 2016 campaign.
Niels, congrats. Yes. Second pole and second victory of the season. What else can you ask for?
Another podium tomorrow would be great from P10. But yeah, if you ask for the race, this one is one of the hardest in my career. Because at some point I was faster than Ascona behind me. But there was one point he was so much quicker. So I thought, how is this possible? So I had to really focus and concentrate. And because of the little set of problems we had in the free practice, I was not managed to do some laps to get used to the car. So for me, after all, I'm so happy and I'm a bit tired too. The sun is out, and but I really like this.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Very happy, Niels Lankveld, as we take a look back at the highlights of the race. And off the line, Ascona anticipated the start better than Lankveld. They made contact on the way towards turn one. Neither driver particularly gaining or losing the advantage. There was then another tap between Ascona and Alex Morgan. Lankveld took the lead and held on to it. Paulsen was chasing Ascona in the early stages, but then the Norwegian developed some damage to his wheel arch, which saw him slipping back. It's Facundo de la Motta and Lucas Oruc engaged in a super scrap. That was the damage to Paulsen, and it meant that Morgan could catch him and was able to sneak past. Lucile Cypriano was another driver who encountered trouble, but until that point she had been in the middle of some super scrapping, but eventually as she went side by side with Marie Bouskapens, something went wrong with the JSB competition car that forced Cypriano to slow it, elevated Marie Bouskapens as well to the lead of the Lady Drivers Trophy. So for Niels Lankveld, a hard victory, but a very, very well executed one. He celebrates his second win of the season. Mikel Scona finishing in second position, and Alex Morgan completing the rostrum with Marie Bouskapens, the winner of the Lady Driver Trophy. So applause for Niels Lankveld in Parc Fermé as drivers about to be announced on to the rostrum. Also taking the opportunity to rehydrate somewhat.
In one moment I think that you I
yeah well it, you, when I, you when you you go like this and have grip and then you turn out there, I was like
Morgan and Ascona sharing a little bit of a laugh, possibly about when they tapped each other through the first term.
This is good for the championship, this year.
Which goes don't win championship.
I overtook Lucile after qualifying, so it's only 2 points, and now I think you and Langevelde.
Paulsen, 2 points me.
Yeah.
And now I'm there, I don't know. Very, very near, I think.
Yeah. Then it's quite a bit of a gap then behind then to me. So.
Tomorrow, Paulsen, will be half very easy.
Not if we work together.
Interesting to overhear the drivers' conversation as they await the podium, already thinking about tactics for tomorrow, because the reverse grid race always presents a unique challenge with the top 10 cars reversed, as it's time to move on to the podium for the fifth round of this year's SEAT Leon Eurocup. So into third place. Applause from the Vaporo team for Alex Morgan. Runner-up, Michele Scona. And the race winner, Niels Langeveld. And Mary Bowles Capens, the Lady Driver Trophy winner.
Mesdames, Mesdemoiselles, Messieurs, en l'honneur des vainqueurs, l'hymne des Pays-Bas.
National anthem in honour of Niels Langeveld. So we'll move on to the presentation of the trophies. So for Wolf Power Racing, third place for Alex Morgan. Runner-up, Michele Scona. I think he enjoyed that. And the winning driver, Niels Langeveld, for the Vaporo team. He receives the cheers and JSB competition, providing our Lady Driver Trophy winner, Marie Bowles-Capens. The drivers will pause briefly for the photos, then make merry with the bubbly, which means it's time from race one here in Paul Ricard from Ben Evans to say thank you very much for joining us, and make sure that you join us for tomorrow. Race two will be on air at 15:35 Central European time as the SEAT Leon Eurocup continues here at Paul Ricard, but today is all about Niels Langeveld, pole position and victory.
Qui a tout le mérite de participer dans cette compétition. Mesdames, Mesdemoiselles, Messieurs, nous allons nous retrouver dans quelques instants pour la suite du programme de cette journée. Et on se retrouve en musique. Merci, Messieurs, congratulations.